Do you remember this man or what he said?
We had already decided our success signal before advancing for the attack, and it was like Bravo Company's success signal, OAIA, which was passed to our CEO Colonel Joshi on the radio set. And after the another bunker was captured, my company's success signal was Ye Dil Mange More. The guys were so highly charged up that they're wanting that some more bunkers should have been there and we would have got the more chaps.
They were words that moved a nation. Words that brought out the fighting spirit of a young breed of Indian soldier. Young men tasked to do what military observers felt was impossible. Climbed near vertical surfaces to take on dug-in enemy soldiers in a war to liberate a part of India. It happened in the summer of 99, in a war broadcast to your homes, a war taking place far, far away in the mountains of Kashmir. A war which was now just a click of your TV remote away. It was a war that regenerated patriotism, pride in the nation, pride in the ability of 20-something soldiers who didn't think twice about marching to their death. India had a new set of young heroes: Vikram Batra, Yogendra Singh Yadav, Manoj Pandey, Sanjay Kumar.
Dushman ke paas pahunchne par humne hamara aur dushmanon ka aamne samne hamara fighting hua aur kareeb इस लड़ाई में 5 घंटे का समय लगा. उस समय हमारे केवल दिमाग के अंदर यही था, अपनी पलटन की इज्जत, अपने देश का जो सम्मान है उसको बढ़ाना है और अपने परिवार वालों का. तो जब हमारा देश सुरक्षित है तो परिवार वाले भी स्वयं सुरक्षित ही होंगे.
They were fighting in a place, in terrain, in climatic conditions as difficult as one can imagine. This was mountain warfare like never before. This is the man who ordered them to fight to the death if necessary. VP Malik was the chief of army staff, the man tasked with the job of commanding the Indian army as it took on a well-entrenched enemy, an enemy which had infiltrated an area deemed too inhospitable for any significant military assault. Malik knew that war and death are synonymous terms, but it was still his job to give the order to send young Indians into what was the lion's den.
The hardest occasion for me, or the hardest time for me every day, was my first morning briefing, where they gave me a count of the casualties of the previous 24 hours. You know, every time you winced when you got the, when you came to know the number, and you felt bad. I think I can say the same thing for the Prime Minister. So whenever I went and I met the people, then I would ask the commanding officer, who are the people, what have they done? And then they will bring up these young officers, men. And I carried these small gifts, scotch bottle, champagne bottle for the officers, and watches or others for the soldiers. And I would give them a pat and a personal appreciation, you know, give them this little gift.
By May 1999, this is what had happened. Taking advantage of the geography of the region, which in many instances favored them, Pakistan Army regulars, accompanied by fully armed and well-trained militants, sneaked into Indian territory to capture heights along the three major fronts, Dras, Kargil and Batalik. The initial target was the National Highway 1A, the only viable road link between Srinagar and the Ladakh region. If the highway fell, Ladakh would have been in peril. In order to take the highway and the towns that surrounded it, the Pakistanis captured several features known well now across the country. Tiger Hill, Tololing, Marpola, Mashko, and areas in Jubar and Turtuk, among others.
If the Indian Army was overwhelmed at the extent of the Pakistani intrusion, then they were perhaps equally overwhelmed at the sight of a large number of young Indian television journalists arriving at a place where angels fear to tread. This was India's first televised war, but the lingo of the Indian Army changed appreciably over the next several weeks. Those young, intrusive, perhaps irritating television journalists were soon seen to be force multipliers, as it became clear that their reportage had a huge impact on international opinion.
And so if the Jawans up front were fighting in a brutal hand-to-hand battle, well behind the front lines, but well within the range of Pakistani artillery, another war was being fought. One for control of the airwaves, one which would influence international opinion. All of a sudden, Kargil and Dras became household names as the nation tuned in to catch what was happening on the war front.
A sign of the changed reality in Kashmir. Just a few years ago, standing at this very spot would have been suicidal. In those ridges behind me are Pakistani observation points, and this stretch of National Highway 1A, the lifeline between Srinagar and Leh, comes under their direct line of fire. And during the Kargil war, they used to pick off targets, trucks and vehicles passing by this stretch. To move up and down this stretch of National Highway 1A just short of Kargil often meant travelling at night at great speeds with your headlights switched off.
Raat ke time light band karke aadmi aane padte hain.
Light band ke kar se
kyunki agar hum light jalayega wo to seedha target karte hain light hum gaadi ko bhaag. Light band karke padta hai. Bahut se gaadi ko accident ho gaya, bahut driver mara gaya.
Many of us were fledgling journalists in 1999. Excited at the prospect of covering war, but totally unprepared for what we saw.
What you heard just now were Bofors guns directly firing right on top of Tiger Hills, the prelude to perhaps the final assault on Tiger Hills, which is expected to begin in just a few hours.
Through those dramatic months, places like Dras and Kargil became home for us. As people moved out, we moved in, never entirely sure if the artillery shells that were thudding into the hills around us would have our names inscribed on them.